morning, and welcome to the virtual Greater Boston Church of Spiritualism on this April Sunday morning. We're so glad that you've joined us. Please join me in our opening prayer. Infinite Spirit, beloved God, we open our hearts and minds to your presence, to your light, and to your love. We ask that you remind each and every one of us that we are a part of you, that we are all sacred beings. We ask that you bring blessings to all of our loved ones and families and friends that we can't be with. We ask special blessings upon all of the healthcare workers, all the people in the food industry, the delivery workers, all those people out there in the world helping to produce the products that the world needs. We give thanks for your presence and for your light within us and around us. Bless the sick. And please help to eradicate this virus. Amen. And today, as we continue our celebration of modern spiritualism, because this week we did celebrate the 172nd anniversary, I asked my students to put together information about some of our wonderful pioneers. So I'm going to use this time in the service each week to present some information that I hope you'll find very interesting. And today I'm going to share with you information gathered by Allison Yeardley on Sir Arthur Conan Doyle. Sir Arthur Conan Doyle was a physician and a scientist. You may know him more commonly as the author who penned the world-famous Sherlock Holmes novels. As a scientist, it took Doyle a good deal of time, a lot of research, and much investigation to accept and advocate for spiritualism. Born in Scotland in 1859, he trained as a doctor before becoming an author. He discovered spiritualism in the 1880s and applied his rigorous scientific mind to the understanding of our religion. According to his son, Conan Doyle felt that the churches had let people down after the First World War. With an entire generation lost to the Great War, including his other son, Sir Arthur Conan Doyle was looking for answers about life after death. Quoted as saying, "Never will I accept anything that cannot be proved to me," he devoted over 40 years to learning about spiritualism through reading, study, and experiment. Along with his wife, he traveled the world to support and promote the movement of spiritualism. And in 1925, he opened a psychic bookshop in London. He wrote books on spiritualism, and his two-volume text, The History of Spiritualism, is valued as an important historical document in our religion. So we give great thanks to Sir Arthur Conan Doyle, who worked hard to bring this religion of spiritualism that we know today into the forefront. And now if you would join me in our healing prayer, and the words will appear on the screen. I ask the great unseen healing force to remove all obstructions from my mind and body and to restore me to perfect health. I ask this in all sincerity and honesty, and I will do my part. I ask this great unseen healing force to help both present and absent ones who are in need of help and to restore them to perfect health. I put my trust in the love and the power of God. So now it's time for our healing meditation, a time where we can let go of all the stress, all the worry, all the fear, and just settle in and take a nice deep breath and allow this healing energy, this loving light that flows from the divine to fill us, to restore us, to renew us, and to bring us back into our state of peace, which is our natural state. So just close your eyes, take a nice deep breath, and allow yourself to focus on your breath, breathing in and breathing out. Allow that breath to bring you a state of relaxation as it flows through you. And as you breathe in, imagine a beautiful light flowing in with your breath. For we realize that the presence of God, the light of God, is always around us, always within us. And so as we breathe in, we take more and more of this divine light into our being. And as we breathe out, we release the stress, the worry, the fear, any strains we're holding on to. Just allow yourself to breathe in the peace and breathe out everything else so that you may be returned to a state of harmony within your being. As you breathe in this light, imagine it flowing through your systems, moving through your bloodstream, reaching into every cell, every particle, every bone, every joint, flowing through every muscle, relaxing all that tension and tightness, flowing into every nerve, renewing and restoring. And just feel this life moving through your body, filling every system, every organ, every particle of you. And imagine your life, your body flooded with light, and that light extending out through your pores so that every part of your body is receiving that healing power that it needs. Feel yourself relaxing more and more as that light flows through you. And imagine that light now not only filling your body but moving through your mind, quieting that busy mind. Imagine a peaceful river flowing through your mind, carrying away those worried thoughts, those fearful thoughts, and filling your mind with light and a knowing that you are safe, that all is well. You are a part of the divine and you are loved and cared for completely. Feel your mind opening and expanding as you lift into that higher mind, where you know that you are loved, you know that you are spirit, you know that you are a part of all that is. And just allow your mind to open, to receive the insight, the inspiration, the wisdom that is all around you from the highest side of life. Allow your mind to open and receive the gift of love that flows to you from your divine source. Feel that love filling your mind and moving through every other particle of you. Feel that divine, unconditional love washing through your emotional body, clearing away all those negative emotions that may have been stuck there. Allow them to flow. Let go of the angers and the hurts, the pains and the fears and the worries that have been there for oh so long. Just breathe and feel that light of God bathing you, cleansing you, clearing you of all the things that have held you back from knowing who you truly are as a divine being, a spark of God on this planet to radiate light. Allow that light of God to flow through every particle of you, filling your heart and opening your heart with love, allowing anything that is not love to flow away from you. For anything that you have held that is not love belongs in the past. The past is gone. Allow yourself to be present in this moment, filled with love, and feel that love flowing out from you as you realize who you are, as a beautiful ray of light, a spark of God, and feel yourself being lifted and carried beyond the physical frame of life, moving into a place of light and peace. And imagine yourself now standing, looking upon a majestic mountain, a beautiful mountain that emanates peace and strength and majesty. And imagine yourself now beginning to walk along a mountain's path, climbing higher and higher on that mountain. And before you, you see a cave that leads to the very center of the mountain. And you can see the light flowing out of that cave, beckoning you, calling you to step inside, to take a break, to take some time to remember who you are. So you follow that light into the cave. You follow it until you reach the very center of the mountain. and you find yourself in a cavern of light, and you feel the most profound peace you have ever felt. There is a silence, there is a peace that permeates every part of you. And as you sit in this cavern of light, taking in this peace, you realize you can understand the secret of the mountain, how it can stand so majestically, emanating strength and peace throughout all the storms of life. Throughout all the difficulties, the mountain stands strong and solid because it holds this peace in the middle, in the core of its being. And so do you. Within you is the peace of this mountain, the peace of God. It exists at the core of your being, and it lets you know in every moment of every day that you are safe, that you are eternal, you are a part of the divine, and you can rest in this peace, in this light, and allow it to bring you into a state of harmony and ease, where you may continue, where you may know that you have the strength you need to carry on, to be at peace in each moment. And as you take in this peace and this light and this knowledge, you feel yourself being lifted high up to the very top of this majestic mountain. And you stand radiating peace, and you feel the rays of God's love shining down upon you, continuing to feed you with what you need to nurture you so that you may continue on. Just as these rays fill the mountain, helping the mountain to stay in that state of majesty and peace, so also it helps you. And as these rays of light flow into you, feel them flowing out from you, flowing into the world as you stand atop this majestic mountain. You can feel and see the rays of God's healing light flowing out into the world, reaching into our planet, reaching all those who are sick, all those lost in fear and anguish and worry. And we feel those rays going into every heart, every mind, every spirit, encircling our globe, filling every part of our earth with light, with healing, and with love. And as we stand, we feel that same healing, that same light, that same love filling us, reminding us that we are here to give out this light, to plug into this light every day, and to realize that the light and the love of God is always with us. It lies within us at the core of our being. So take it in. Allow this healing light to bring to you what you need today to continue on. And as you breathe, feel yourself gently coming back to the room, feeling the clothes upon your body, the chair that you are sitting on, coming back gently and easily, but bringing with you the knowledge that the light and love and healing grace of God lies within you. All is well. You are loved. You are safe. Breathe that in and feel the peace continuing to fill you so that you may walk forward in this life, facing any storm, knowing all is well, for that peace and that love is there for you now and always. Take a nice deep breath as you feel yourself grounding back to the space. And as you open your eyes, smile and know that all is well, that you are safe, that you are loved beyond measure. You will always be a divine ray of God. You always have been You always will be. You are eternal. And now, if we're all back, join me in saying our principles. We have a set of principles that guide us in our lives, and the words will appear before you on the screen if you read along with me. We believe in infinite spirit and that God is infinite spirit. We believe that the phenomena of nature, both physical and spiritual, are the expression of infinite spirit. We affirm that a correct understanding of such expression and living in accordance therewith constitute true religion. We affirm that the existence and personal identity of an individual continue after the change called death. We affirm that communication with the so-called dead is a fact scientifically proven by the phenomena of spiritualism. We believe that the highest morality is contained in the golden rule, whatsoever ye would that others should do unto you, do ye also unto them. We affirm the moral responsibility of the individual, and that they make their own happiness or unhappiness as they obey nature's physical and spiritual laws. We affirm that the doorway to reformation is never closed against any human soul here or hereafter, and we affirm the precepts of prophecy and healing contained in the Bible are divine attributes proven through mediumship. Well, today I would like to speak to you about hope. It is so important that we hold on to hope in these days ahead. They say the next 2 weeks are crucial, that we stay in our homes, that we hold on to hope and know that this too will pass. You know, hope is a choice. Hope helps us to seek the positive, to remain optimistic. Hope helps us to trust in the higher power at work in our lives. And hope helps us to know that help is always there. Hope keeps our faith alive. And don't we need that right now? I want to tell you a little story about four candles. Once upon a time, there were four candles. One was peace, one was love, one was faith, and one was hope. And they all burned brightly for the world. They shined so brightly that they held that energy for the world. But one day, peace looked around the world, and he saw the fighting. He saw nations fighting against nations, saw people fighting against people, and wherever he looked, he couldn't find peace. And so in its sadness, the flame went out. Well, love, standing beside peace, saw peace's flame go out and started to look out into the world for love. And he looked within the hearts of men and saw that their love was buried with anger and negativity and regret and all kinds of negative emotions stuck in their hearts like boulders. And he looked around the world and he couldn't find love. And so in its sadness, the flame went out. Well, faith, standing next to peace and love, got really upset as he saw these two flames going out in the world. And he looked out into the world to see who held faith in their hearts. And he looked around and he saw that people didn't have faith in themselves. They didn't have faith in each other. And they didn't have faith in the higher power even. And so faith went out. The flame was extinguished, and the only flame left in the world was hope. And hope looked around and saw that it needed to shine even brighter. Hope looked around and said, if I go out, all will be lost. And so hope gathered its strength and stood tall and strong and began to shine brighter and brighter and brighter until that light of hope reached every heart. And the flame of that hope was so large that it ignited faith. And when faith began to shine brightly, then that faith was rekindled in the hearts of men. And they began to believe again in each other, in themselves, and in the divine power that was at work in their life. And faith continued to shine brighter. And as hope and faith shone so bright, they ignited love. And love began to shine, and hearts began to open, and people began to love again and let go of the past and start anew. And then love grew so strong that it ignited peace. And with all the love in people's hearts, peace once again ruled the world. Isn't that a lovely story? I love it because it shows us that hope can really save us. If we stay in a place of hope, we can rekindle our faith. We can bring our love forward into the world. We can maintain peace in our lives during this quarantine. Love and peace and hope are so important in our lives. Holding faith and all those things, they don't live outside of us. They live in here. They live within us. And it's up to us to choose to find them, to ignite our own lights and to bring them forward into our world and into our everyday life. You know, the Master Jesus was a great teacher. And he left behind so many wonderful teachings. And these teachings are for everyone. They're not just for one religion. They're for everyone. And I love listening and reading about the parables. And one of my favorite parables is the one he talked about. The kingdom of heaven was buried in a field. And he asked his followers, will you sell everything to buy that field? Well, I'm sure that his followers were a little bit confused on which field to buy. But I'm wondering, what is he asking of us? Is he not asking, will we look within to find that kingdom of God? Will we let go of our attachments to the physical stuff that was once so important? Now that we're in this quarantine, we're realizing it's not the stuff that's important, is it? It's the people. It's the love we hold. It's not the stuff. So when we think about that parable, the Master Jesus was teaching us to pay attention to our spirituality first and foremost, and then everything else will fall into place. But we all need a spiritual practice. We all need to recognize that we are spirit first and foremost. We are spiritual beings, and we need to bring a spiritual practice into our lives if we're going to maintain that hope, that faith, that peace, and that love. The only way to do it is to get in touch with who you really are. Take the time to look within, to develop a spiritual practice that works for you. There are so many wonderful tools to create that practice, to help you become aware of your own spirituality. And to practice that each and every day, not just in quarantine, but forever. Because we can't forget who we really are. We need to be reminded each and every day, and it is through our spiritual practice that we are reminded. The greatest spiritual practice is prayer and meditation. I think of prayer as conversing with the divine. Let God know what you're feeling, what you're thinking, what you're needing. Build a relationship with the divine. Talk to God. Let God know. I feel like I just have conversations. Here's what I'm feeling. Here's what I'm thinking. And ask for guidance, for wisdom, for inspiration. Ask for what can I do to make it better. Not God, fix it for me, but what can I do to make my world better? What can I do to make my life better? That's the kind of inspiration that flows from the divine into our hearts. And it is in meditation where we open to receive that insight, that inspiration. In meditation, we listen for the voice of God, which is that small voice within us. Because remember, God lives within us, within all of us. We don't have to go far away to get our answers. It's right here. But if we don't develop a spiritual practice to connect into who we really are, into that divine presence within us, then we won't hear the answers, will we? So it's doing it each and every day, a practice of meditation and prayer, a practice of listening, that we receive our answers, that we receive that profound peace that we felt hopefully in that meditation. So prayer and meditation is an important thing to put into every day. First thing in the morning is the best time. But do it any time of the day that you have 10 minutes. That's all you need. 10 minutes to change your life. Will you do that? Another thing that I have learned throughout my life, a wonderful tool that I learned from a wonderful Buddhist monk, Thich Nhat Hanh, who has written many, many books, and his teachings are so simple that they couldn't be easier. And Thich Nhat Hanh teaches breathing in, I know I'm breathing in. Breathing out, I know I'm breathing out. It's mindfulness. Being mindful of your breath brings you into this sacred moment of now. And we breathe in. We breathe in light and love, and we breathe out, and we release our tension and stress. Breathing in, I breathe in that light of God. Breathing out, I release that light into the world and make a difference. So simple. And just doing that one or two, three times, you can feel the peace that flows through you. Breath is our most important tool, and it's so cool because it's always with us. We don't have to go find a candle and light it. We don't have to go put on a CD that will help us to relax. We don't have to do anything. We just have our breath wherever we are. We have a practice that will work for us, that will bring us into a state of peace. Breathing in. I breathe in the light and the love of God. Breathing out, I release it into the world, and I do my part to make this world a better place. Doesn't that feel wonderful? So a spiritual practice is something that we choose to do each and every day. It reminds us who we are, and it helps us to move forward in our life and to truly live our purpose. I talked a little bit about looking for our purpose last week, but it's important to remember that our purpose is not one big thing. Our purpose is what we do in each moment. And our purpose is tied to how we help, how we uplift. It's tied to our kindness and how we can help humanity. I asked my students this week on what they were doing when they felt their spirit alive and living fully. We have glimpses of that, and we feel so alive, and we know that this is what we're meant to do. And I asked them all, what were you doing? And every one of them answered, I was serving. I was serving and helping someone. I was uplifting someone. I was making a difference in someone's life. Living a life of service is helping wherever we can, wherever we are. And that is where our true joy is, where our true purpose is. So allow yourself to feel the joy of living your purpose in every moment. When you help, when you uplift, when you share something that makes someone smile, you are living your purpose. And you are expressing the divine within you. Our principles tell us we are all of creation and expression of God. So as we move through life, we must seek that expression of God within everyone we meet. Look for that presence of God within all of creation. Look for that presence of God within you. Look for that presence of God within the person you're interacting with. Imagine if we're all expressing God in beautiful ways, what a wonderful world we will have. But it is up to us, because we're all a choice. We choose to keep hope and faith and love and peace alive in our lives and share that with all the world. I encourage you all to begin or continue your spiritual practice. Nurture that spirit each and every day. Stay connected to your source, which is God. We can never be disconnected, but our awareness moves away. So bring your awareness back each day to that connection, to the presence of God that lives within you. And allow yourself to grow and expand and to live from a place of peace and harmony so that you can shine brightly and really make this world a better place. We're all a part of it. It's up to each and every one of us. Because when we connect to that divine presence within, when we remember that that kingdom of God is within us, that we can literally create heaven on earth, each and every one of us. But remember, it's a choice to create heaven or hell, because heaven and hell are states of consciousness, states of mind. So think about what you want in your life. You can create heaven by plugging into that kingdom of God that is within you and doing your best to live the best life you can live. You know, next week is Easter. And Easter is a time of rebirth and a time of resurrection. And I came across something that I'd like to share with you. I shared it a few years ago. And I believe the origins may have come from Pope Francis. I think I tweaked them a little bit. But they're ways to be a better you. And I'm going to read them to you. I'm also posting them on our website, so if you want to copy them and hang them on your fridge, it will remind you little things that you can do to make your life better. Fast from indifference so you can feast on love. Fast from hurtful words and transmit kind words. Fast from anger and live with understanding. Fast from pessimism and transmute it to optimism. We really need that now. Fast from worries and fear and trust in God. Trust that all is well, this too will pass. Fast from complaints, they don't do us any good. And choose to see what is right and good around you. Fast from pressure and stress, and instead start your day with prayer and surrender to the higher power at work in your life. Fast from lack of forgiveness and anger, and take on an attitude of reconciliation and forgiveness so that we can live in peace and harmony and start anew. Prepare to be the best that you can be, and your life and your world will transform around you. Remember, we create our own reality. That's the truth. We are in charge of our attitude. We're in charge of ourselves. So take charge and be the best you that you can be. And please choose heaven. And now we will have a musical selection by Damien LaCount, who will sing God, I Need You Now. Couldn't be more appropriate.
Well, everybody's got a story to tell, and everybody's got a wound to be healed. I wanna believe there's beauty here, 'cause tired of holding on. I can't let go, I can't move on. I wanna believe there's meaning here. How many times have you heard me cry out, God, please take this? How many times have you given me strength to just keep breathing? Oh, I need you, God, I need you now. Standing on a road I didn't plan, wondering how I got to where I am.
Portion of our service, and as you know, I'm working very differently. I'm used to giving messages to people who are sitting in front of me, but I'm going to blend with the world of spirit and invite all of the loved ones to come in. And I know that I don't know who's sitting out there waiting for a message, but I know that the spirit world does know. So whether you watch it on Sunday or Tuesday, your loved ones will be guiding you to watch the service and to receive the messages. I ask the spirit world to bring through their wisdom, what they've learned in their lives, so it helps not only the person that they're connected to, but everyone who's listening. They have tremendous wisdom to share. We also do this work to prove that life continues. That's what spiritualism is all about. And I'm encouraging you, if you recognize a loved one, to please send in an email or make a comment that you've recognized your loved one so that we know we're reaching you. I want to thank everybody who sent in the emails last week to let us know that their messages were received. And I'm hoping, you know, every time we work with the spirit world, it's an experiment. So I'm going to open and allow the spirit world and those individuals to come through me to bring messages of love and wisdom. I know that last week when I did this, there were many spirits coming in together that had similarities. And oftentimes I call this streamlined mediumship. Spirits from the other side that have similarities will come in together. And sometimes you'll feel that this piece of evidence doesn't go with the original person, but that's because there are other people adding in their pieces of information. If I had you in front of me, I could separate them all and let you know who they belong to. But I'm counting on you to open and keep your minds open, your hearts open. If you understand some of the information, please take it, because there's so many trying to come through and to reach you and share their love and their support and their wisdom. So I'm going to open up now and see who comes through. Okay, I feel like I have a presence of a gentleman who is standing directly behind me, and he feels like a man of strength. I feel like he would be a father because he stands very tall and strong, and I feel very, very narrow with him. Very tall, very narrow, very long legs. And I feel like he would have been someone who would have done construction work or worked outside, because I have the construction boots on, and I feel like I know tools very well. And I feel like I've got a tool belt on, and I feel like I can fix anything. So I feel like as he comes in, he's moving through life in a very, he says, serious way. He was kind of a quiet gentleman, and I feel like he would have not offered a lot of information about himself, because he feels kind of private to me and kind of quiet. I feel like when he was home, he's showing me a gathering with a bunch of kids around and a beautiful wife, and he loved his wife greatly and he loved his children. But I felt like sitting in the chair and reading his paper was important to him, and so he needed his quiet time as well. I feel like he wasn't afraid to get his hands dirty. He wasn't afraid to do all the jobs. I feel like he would have been a boss in his company, but he wasn't afraid to get down there and do every job. He's telling me he's a self-made man, and he worked his way up to create his own business, and he learned through the trades everything he could possibly learn. And I feel like he taught his children that they needed to work from the ground up if they ever wanted to be successful. And I feel like he's coming in today to help his family who are having a difficult time right now. I feel like they're separated because of this quarantine. So I feel like I've got, you know, some of his kids over here with their families, some over here with their families, and everybody is spread out so far that there's a lot of fear and worry, and they don't feel like they're connected anymore. And he's coming in to say, you're always connected. It's your hearts that connect you. It's not the space. So the physical distance doesn't matter. It's the hearts of love that you hold for each other. And I feel like in the family there have been there has been some time since there's been a gathering or people have talked to one another, and he's encouraging all of his kids and all of you, pick up the phone, connect to other people, connect to the ones you love, because all it takes is a voice. When you hear the voice of your loved one, you can relax. So you may not be thinking that your loved ones are missing you, but they are. So this is for everyone. Call the people you love. You may not be able to get together with them, but you can talk to them on the phone. And he says, enough with the emails and the texts. Use your voice. We're always typing, and he's watching as they text each other. And he's saying texts and emails and all that technology is good, but please, you need to share each other's voices, because there's something about the vibration of the voice that goes to the heart. And when you're talking, think of the good memories. He's bringing me a lot of memories of going to the beach and playing in the sand and laughing and joking. I'm seeing picnics, I'm seeing barbecues, I'm seeing a lot of really fun times in the growing up years. And he's saying, you'll have those fun times again. So don't give up. Maintain that hope in your heart. And the first thing you should do when this is all over is have a family reunion and get everybody together and laugh and play again, because you all really need it. And I feel like this is really for his family, but also for all the families out there that are separated. Get together. Plan those reunions. A lot of vacations have been canceled, but when this is over, plan new ones, but plan better ones, ones that have to do with people, not places. Okay? So I'm going to leave you. He's such a loving man. And he says this isn't his norm to be so out there to tell people what to do. But I feel like he's got some other men with him that are really helping him to be the spokesperson. And I feel like some of these other men are coming in to tip the hat. I feel like I've got another father and grandfather here. And he feels a much broader. I feel like I've got very short, buzzed here with him. And it's gray as he comes in, but I feel like a round face and a large body as well. And I feel like he worked outside and he did work with tools and construction and things as well. So they've come in like buddies together. But he's talking about how strong you need to be. And he said he stood strong in his life. This gentleman was most definitely a boss. I feel like he had many people under him. And I feel like he may have instilled fear in his employees sometimes and his family, because he stuck to his guns and he didn't let people get away with anything, he's saying. He always was watching to make sure that things were done right. And I feel like with this man, he's talking about the quality was the most important to him. Because I feel like he built things. He built homes and he built buildings. And he's saying the quality of the building was far more important. And his employees did fear him because they had a standard to reach up to. And if they didn't reach up to that standard, they were gone and they knew it. And so he was a tough guy. He was strong and powerful in his integrity of his work. And I feel like he was the same. He was similar to his family, because I feel like he was very strict with his children as well. I'm seeing three children. I see two boys and a girl with him. And I feel like he was very strict, or more strict to the boys than the girl. And I feel like he expected the great things from them. But he's also saying, I might have held the standard too high and I didn't know when to bring it down a little bit to help you feel successful. He said, I always kept good. You did good, so here, reach this next. Instead of spending time with appreciating the good that you did do. So I feel like in some ways he's apologizing for not noticing or giving you the credit that you needed to continue to reach for the next step. Because I feel like within the group of three, you didn't all grow up with a great sense of self-esteem that he wished he created in you. He's making me feel like he's trying to come around you now and help you to understand that he knows you did the best that you could and that you continue to do the best that you can. And I feel like he's coming in with a lot of pride for all three of you. And I feel like he really, really wants you to know that he's got your back, he's behind you, and he sees the good that you've done and the good that you've created in this life. and to focus more on the good things that you've done and to not be so concerned about pushing yourselves beyond your limits. Give yourself credit when you reach your limit before you go beyond it. Take your time. He's given me the sense that he pushed maybe a little bit too hard, and he's sorry for that. And he said, some of you are pushing yourself and continue to push yourself and are never satisfied with what you've accomplished. Stop. Be satisfied with what you've accomplished because it's good. And give yourself the credit. Allow yourself to process that you've accomplished something so that you can move forward with more self-esteem, with more understanding who you are, with more strength in who you are, and more knowledge of the abilities that you have. Don't second guess. Just give yourself some credit because he's here to give you credit. And I feel like he has a great love for his family, and he's really strong in trying to give that out to you. So please take his love, take his strength, and take his support, because that's what he always wanted to give you. Even to his employees, even as hard as he was supportive of them. And it was just, he sees as he looks at his life now, that the way he presented, oftentimes people didn't get it, but he did everything out of the goodness of his heart. And that was always his intent. And he says, I want you all to understand the intent that I had, that I only wanted the good for everyone. So I'm going to leave you with their blessings and lots of love and support from him, because he's adding his strength to everyone. I feel like I have a woman who's coming in, and she feels very lighthearted. I feel very grandmotherly with her, although she's a mother as well. So I feel like she's here to reach out to her children and her grandchildren. I feel like she would have sang. She would have had a lovely voice. She didn't sing professionally, she tells me. But she hummed and she sang around the house and she tried to make things lighter for everyone. I feel a really pleasant personality. I feel like she would have worked outside the home. She would have worked with people. She had a really pleasing personality. So I'm feeling like she's in some sort of customer service because she worked with people and she helped to make things better for people. So I feel like she was a great one to put in the complaints department, because she could just make people smile and feel better and fix things. So she was, to me, a fixer, she says. And she kept her pleasant personality no matter what, she tells me. No matter what was going on in the world, she knew it was up to her to hold that attitude of pleasantry and to help people smile and help people get beyond their angers, and that she could calm people down just with her voice. She keeps bringing me that voice letting me know that when she sang, it lifted her heart. And she's reminding her children and her grandchildren and everyone to listen to the music that lifts you up. Hum along, sing along, because it will help you to get beyond the difficulties that you're facing right now. There is so much pain out there. There's so much worry, so much fear. And I feel like she's coming in to just bring this pleasant personality to say, it's all going to be okay. And that's what she would have done with her presence, with her voice, with the words she spoke. She helped people to be put at ease and helped people relax. When you were with her, you knew you could do anything. She's showing me memories of her sitting at the kitchen table with the kids around her and helping with homework. And I feel like she was encouraging with the homework. And I feel like she would have also done some of this with her grandchildren, because I know that her grandchildren loved her, and I feel like she would sit and do quiet things with them. And I feel like helping with homework and helping them learn things was some of her greatest joy, because she could see their smile when they accomplished. And I feel like when they could figure out a math problem because she helped them, the smile was so wide. It wouldn't have been as wide if she gave them the answers. So I feel like she really learned in her life how to help people find within themselves what they need. So she's given me the scenario of the homework, but I feel like she did that everywhere, in everything that she did. She reached in and helped other people find within themselves what they need. And I feel like she comes in very proud. I feel like she's got daughters, and she's so proud of them because she's saying, my girls found within themselves what they needed to rise above the challenges and to be who they were and to be successful in who they were. And she's saying success doesn't come from money. It comes from how people respect you, how people honor you. And I feel like this woman was highly respected, and she worked a lot with people in many different areas. I feel like she may have changed jobs or moved into different directions as she got older, and she learned a lot from the interactions she had with people. And I feel like she's saying, I know my girls are following in my footsteps, moving up the ladders of success and making sure that they're making a difference and doing something good for the world. So she's really encouraging everyone to find within themselves what they can offer, and then do that. Do that with love, do that with joy. She took great joy in everything that she did. And she says that's where you need to be in life. If you're trudging off to work and doing something that you don't love and you're miserable, and you come home and you're miserable, what kind of life is that? Find what you love, do what you love, put your whole self into it, and allow all the talents that you have to come forward into that work. She said, don't waste time doing something that you hate. Do what you love, and sing along, and learn what you want to learn, and follow your own heart and soul. And I leave you with her love and blessings and her wonderful, pleasant personality. I feel like I have another woman who's stepping in here, and I feel her very peaceful as she steps in. I feel like she's bringing me peace as she blends with me. I feel very religious with her, very prayerful. I feel like she had a great religious calling. I feel like she wouldn't have been one to preach, but she was one to live her religion, and one to really trust in the faith and the love of God. I feel her not too tall. I feel like she's probably about my height, rather slight. She's coming in kind of neat and tidy, and I feel like she would have been a very neat and tidy person. She would have, I have a crisp collar, so I feel like she would have ironed, and she's coming and she's laughing. She says, I ironed everything. I think she even ironed the sheets, because the iron was always up and always out, and everything had to be just so neat and clean. And she was very particular about those types of things, and no wrinkles. But she's laughing about that now. She said that stuff really didn't matter, but it kept her busy and it made her happy. She said sometimes, you know, little things bothered her, and it was just part of her personality that she liked things in place. And she said, I had to get over that when I got older. I feel like as she got older, she was in either a hospital or a nursing home environment. I feel like she was downsized into something very small. And I feel like that was more manageable for her. I felt she couldn't get around really well. I feel brittle in my legs. I felt like she would have lost weight and was very slight before she passed. And I feel really small ankles with her. But I feel like in the downsized space, she was able to handle that. She could move around in it rather than where she had lived before. It was so much work that she had to keep everything meticulous. So I'm not feeling a lot of children with her. I feel like she's shows herself alone in her home and alone in the nursing facility. But I also feel her very happy in that. I feel like she would be somebody's aunt rather than mother. I feel like there's people that come to visit her and bring her things, and there were people in her life that loved her very dearly, and she loved them. So I feel like she would have been an aunt that would have reached out and had really good connections to her nieces and her nephews. But I feel like she looked forward to the visits when they came, but she was good at being alone. And she said, I learned through my faith and through my connection to my God that I was fine wherever I was. I didn't need a lot. I didn't need a lot of people as I got older. I let go of all those belongings that took so much work to take care of. And I found my peace really in this little small environment that I didn't need to do any work. I could just be and I could sit in peace. I felt like she would have had a prayer book that she would have read over and over again, because I felt like the pages are very, very worn and I hardly can see the writing in it anymore because she had had it for so many years and read it every day. But she didn't need to even read it. She knew every word by heart. And she's saying that was important to me. That was my prayerful time, my time to connect to God. And that's what kept me happy and in peace with whatever occurred in my life. She didn't necessarily appreciate getting old and her body failing, but she was able to move through it in a place of peace and trusting. And she's letting me know that she had a very peaceful death. She just sort of slipped over. And she said there was no drama or trauma. Her life was peaceful. Her life was filled with God, and her life just continued on. And she's still with the divine and happy in the spirit world. But she's coming in today to say thank you to those loved ones that came to visit her. And I'm seeing they would bring her little flowers or little plants. And that really filled her heart with so much love. She says, you have no idea how much the little things that you did for me mattered to me. All my life, those little things mattered. And she's here to encourage people to connect to your loved ones that might be alone, that the older people that don't have children of their own. You may have aunts and uncles in facilities or nursing homes or elderly housing, and no, you can't visit them now. But she said, keep in touch with them and let them know you care. And when this is over, make sure to go and see them, that and give them a medal for surviving this virus, because that's a big thing for the elderly, that they're going to survive this this virus. So celebrate them when this is over, please, and have a party with them and bring them something to let you know that you care, because she seems to be the advocate for the elderly as she comes in here, and also the advocate for prayer. So please take her love and her blessings and her advice, and we thank her very much for coming in and for sharing a wonderful piece with me. I feel her peace is so strong that she just radiates that. And to realize that Whatever you hold within you that is strong, it radiates out to the people that are around you. She can radiate to me because she's very strong in her energy and her peace. Well, we can be that here. We don't have to die to be that. She's letting me know. We can be that here, and we can emanate this peace to other people. And just our presence can help the people around us. So if we're home with people, just sit and feel your own peace flowing out from you so that it gets into them. Because you can make a difference just from your being, as she is making a difference with me here. And I thank her for coming. A lovely, lovely, beautiful soul. So we hope that you have all enjoyed the messages from the spirit world. Know that each and every one of you has been touched by the love of spirit. Believe me, they are there. Open your hearts and receive their love and send your love out to them because they do get it. Remember, we're never alone. We're spirit now, always have been, always will be. So take their love and know that you're supported. And now just a few announcements. Just a reminder that our virtual services will continue. And if you have recognized a message today and been touched by the messages, if you could send a comment or an email. Again, I'm grateful to the people who contacted me last week. If you can let me know that we're reaching you, that would be greatly appreciated. Also, if you could, if you're watching this, if you could like the channel and subscribe, you'll get a notification when we post again. So there's more meditations coming out that will be posted on this channel, and you'll be notified if you subscribe. So we hope you will subscribe and like the channel so others can see it as well. Big thank you to Rob and Damien who were in our video today. It's so nice to be able to share the videos of the music that took place in our physical space. It just helps us to remember what that physical space looks like now that we've been out of it for 4 weeks. It's nice to see it each and every week. So we're hoping to continue to share those videos. Note that Dominic, who was scheduled to come in May, will not be coming. I'm sure you've probably all guessed that those flights are canceled. So we won't be seeing Dominic in May, but hopefully we'll see him in October. And I think a reminder to donate to the church. We do still have bills to pay, so we're very grateful for your generosity. If you can make a donation, there's a few donate buttons on the website. And don't forget to copy and paste those things that will help you live a better life. Those will also be on the website when you're viewing this. So let us close our service with a closing prayer with great gratitude to Infinite Spirit, to our loved ones, to our guides and our teachers and angels who are always around us, supporting us. We give thanks to them for their presence in our life. We give thanks for the healing and the peace that flows to us always from our infinite source. May we all open our hearts, live in love and peace, live with hope and generosity. May we all remember who we are as spirits of God, divine sparks on earth. May we hold the peace that we need to carry on throughout these weeks of quarantine, so that we can do our part to keep people at ease. And may we all know that all is well. We're always connected and loved. Amen. Have a great week, everyone.